Hello again. With me today is host of the Michael Knowles Show. He's also author of a fake book and a real book, to his credit.
Which is which?
Which is which? Well, they'll have to buy them to tell, right? And he is co-host of the Verdict with Ted Cruz podcast. Michael, good to see you.
Good to see you. Long time no see.
It has it.
I haven't seen you in Florida in quite some time.
That's true. I haven't seen you in Florida. I saw you in Washington, D.C. Mm-hmm. I saw you in Texas. Uh-huh. I saw you in Wisconsin.
Yeah.
All within the last 10 days.
Yes. That's a whirlwind. And we haven't been traveling together.
No, that's the funny part is we've gone in different places in between.
But you've got precious cargo. See, for me, it's me. Occasionally, I bring a suitcase. Often, I do not. You bring this, my sweet little future daughter-in-law.
That's
you
know, true. Betrothed to your son.
Yes.
Born 2 days apart. Congratulations, by the way. It was so on Verdict.
Oh, thank you.
I mean, I was honored to take part in the tour the last 10 days, the three on the road live Verdict tours. This has been something that you have grown with Senator Ted Cruz for the past almost 2 years since the impeachment trial. You guys have done outstanding. You should be very proud of that.
Thank you very much. It is strange that we started Verdict in the first impeachment. You have to specify
the
first and the second. And we started it and it was going to just go for impeachment. And I thought the show would do fine. I have to tell you, all due respect to Senator Cruz, I did not think that he would beat Joe Rogan on the podcast charts. And then it happened, you know, and we hit number one on the charts. And so we kept the thing going. I can't believe it's been 2 years now. It was really pretty edifying to see that we went to Wisconsin and Texas and DC and very different crowds and very different perspectives of these crowds. But they were all, almost 1,000 people in the room and, 100,000 people watching live and a lot more since then. So it's been wonderful. And I think it shows you that people are interested in politics. They are interested in having a say in their government. They don't think that they're getting a say through the ordinary channels. And so they want to see a little bit behind the curtain and engage in these new media.
Yeah. And this is what I give credit to both you, because I think you bring this out in him and Senator Cruz for lifting that curtain, because politicians, as you know, are so political. They memorize their talking points. They don't want to be asked a question that's more than 30 seconds. They don't want to give a glimpse into their thought process or, how the sausage is made, basically. And Senator Ted Cruz is willing to do that. That's what he's doing at each and every one of these. The show is sure, but the events even more so, because it's live, it's talk, it's interacting with an audience. And I to be honest, I have been very surprised, pleasantly surprised. He's a very funny man.
He's very funny. He is. And
I didn't expect that, to be honest.
The other thing, I don't just want to flatter him or but
I just said I didn't expect that. So it's a backhanded compliment.
True. You're not flattering. But when you mention that most politicians don't actually say anything, part of the reason they don't say anything, one is because they're cautious and they just want to get reelected. But part of it is that just the average IQ in Washington, D.C. is not particularly high. And I once asked a very well-known Democratic strategist, I said, what do you think of these politicians, who've made your career? And he said, they're vacuous imbeciles, all of them.
It's true.
And so,
Mostly.
No, it is. And so when you get someone like Cruz, and there are other people too. I mean, there are a handful of other politicians on the scene, but there aren't many of them who actually know something about the law, know something about the Constitution, know something about history, have some thoughts about philosophy and the way the government should work, have know anything beyond the talking points that some pollster hands them. It's so refreshing. So I do think that is part of the reason why the podcast has worked. And, that's part of the reason why we're here now at this National Conservatism Conference.
Yeah.
And one of the purposes of this conference is to break out of those dead talking points and to cremate.
To disagree.
I think we're not killing the dead consensus, because the dead consensus is already dead. We're cremating it. We're having a funeral for the dead consensus and then moving on to something.
Throwing the ashes into the wind. So one of my favorite moments that happened backstage during this tour, first, like I said, Wisconsin, then Houston, Texas A&M, then Catholic University, was the disagreements. You and Senator Cruz actually have very differing views on some very important topics. And, when you're waiting backstage in the wings, when the introduction is going on stage, you kind of are naturally gearing up your mind to talk about these things, right? And so you'll not practice, but you'll share a thought about what we're about to talk about. And Senator Cruz, you are about to disagree with something he was saying. And he literally says, save it for the stage.
Yep. Yeah.
No. He doesn't even want a chance to prepare for the disagreement. He wants people to be able to see how it's broken down. I have an immense amount of respect for that.
There was this great moment. I think it was the highlight of the tour at Catholic University.
Yes.
And a student comes up at Catholic and says, Senator Cruz, you talk about liberty a lot. could you define liberty? Because, and Mr. Knowles, could you define liberty too? Because I think you might disagree. And so the senator very graciously let me go first. And I gave this definition of liberty, which Lord Acton gave. And it's a Catholic definition of liberty, which is that liberty is not the right, it's not the ability to do whatever you want, but the right to do what you ought. Yeah. And St. John Paul II reiterated this in recent years, and it's just, that's the Catholic definition, right? Now, the sort of libertarian or liberal definition of liberty is that liberty is just the ability to do whatever you want. And it gets a little confusing because our will is split. Meaning, you know, if I'm a drug addict, I want to do the drugs. But in a higher sense, I don't want to do the drugs, right? And so St. Paul says this. He says, what I want to do, I don't do. And what I don't want to do, I do. What does that mean? It's because we have appetite and we have a rational will. And the rational will mediates between the appetite and the divine will. And so that's why we educate ourselves and practice virtue. Okay. So then Senator Cruz says, yeah, that's a bunch of Catholic claptrap. But he said it in a very nice way.
But he did get a big laugh even from the Catholic audience.
He did. He did. And it was, and he made this great point where he said, I don't know if the difference is because I'm Protestant and you're Catholic, but I think liberty is not really necessarily ordered toward virtue, but it really is just the ability to do whatever you want to do. And this is an open debate right now. And what I thought was more impressive, even than the open disagreement, is the graciousness of a sitting United States senator. This is a presidential candidate and a very serious guy to allow his junior partner in this endeavor, in this podcast, to have this open and direct and serious a disagreement with him. I don't know any politician in the country who would tolerate that, right? I mean, is why politician podcasts are so boring, is because it's just, you know, the politician says something, usually some stupid thing, and then whoever else is on the screen says, oh, yes, how yes, wonderful yes, yes, and brilliant and handsome of you. And it's just the graciousness of that is really rare and impressive. And
I even got a chance to weigh in on this. And I was simply a guest on this tour.
Yep.
I mean, my views on, you know, liberty versus license, I guess, is like a hybrid of those two, because as a Catholic, of course, you know, I my views align with yours that, you know, we're called to virtue. But when it comes to government regulating our ability to do something good or something bad, I do fall a little bit more towards the libertarian end of the spectrum, simply because that's what God allowed of us as human beings, to choose the wrong thing. We had to be able to choose to do the wrong thing in order to choose the right thing.
Well,
that's the idea of free will, right? He gave us free will. He gave us the ability to choose the devil versus to choose him, without which we would just be animals with instinct, and our choice would mean nothing.
No, that's true. You certainly need free will. But God also allows the civil authority to put restraints on these things, right? He doesn't say you have the right to commit a murder. You know, I will not allow the civil authority to proscribe murder. And so then it becomes this negotiation. I mean, what kind of limits do we want to put on that kind of freedom? You know, so
limits should obviously be if you've infringed upon someone else's ability to, you know, exercise those same things, those choices, someone else's ability to just live out their individual liberties, right? Okay. If you're violating someone else's liberties, that's different than choosing. And I understand the argument that if you make a bad moral choice, it has cascading effects, and you are essentially morally crippling someone else, not necessarily the person with which you know, if it's a sexual sin that you did that with, if you will.
Who have you been talking PG. To? Who you hold on here? Have you been?
I understand that, but I just think it's very risky for a government to get involved in the regulation of that, because as soon as you have any politician, the Democratic Party right now is a perfect example of this. They're redefining the very idea of right and wrong, good and bad, moral and immoral.
And they're wielding that power.
Yes. But then isn't, and so if you give a government that power, then...
But the government already has that power because the left is already doing it. So my question then is, what about drug laws? You know, let's say, not forget about drunk driving laws, but just actual doing the drug or possessing the drug. That is not something that infringes on someone else's liberty in some very remote way, perhaps. But really, it's just about, do you have the right to smoke the doobie or shoot the heroin or smoke the crack? And it seems to me the conservative answer, and the answer that most people held in the country until very recently, was no, you don't have that right. Even though it doesn't infringe on someone else's rights, you do not have the right to use your body in that way.
This where our system of government in general has gotten very off track? Because to get very nerdy here, the federal government was supposed to be more libertarian, more hands-off, and the state governments and the local governments were the ones that had the ability to say, okay, morality, sure, let's regulate what we want our communities to be, as long as we are not violating those inherent rights that are codified
in laws, right?
Protected in the Constitution. And maybe that's true, because I understand the drug argument, the war on drugs. This is actually a very interesting conservative case study when you ask people these days, well, what do you think of the war on drugs? Should the federal government be involved here? You'll get people who don't know how to answer it, because their answers will be inconsistent. Even my own. Yeah. I've had to really critically think, well, should the federal government be banning marijuana, even though all the science shows that marijuana is not only bad for the individual, it leads to mental health problems, which burdens our hospitals, leads to violence, which harms other people. At the same time, you can't ban a behavior that simply makes someone have a propensity to do something bad.
Can you not, though?
State level is what I would argue. At the federal level, no.
At the federal level, I suppose it's harder, although what they would argue is interstate commerce, because all the pot's coming over from Mexico and going through all the states that you can regulate it. But, I was just thinking about this for the topic, the speech today, which was basically about all the things we should ban. But I was looking at sodomy laws in the United States. The Supreme Court decided to upend sodomy laws. They found some anti-sodomy law provision in invisible ink in the Constitution. I don't know where they found it, but this was very recently that they did that. Before that, it was considered perfectly within a state's right to ban sodomy. Maybe you don't want to. I mean, maybe there's no reason to do that. But at the time of the Revolution, the punishment for sodomy in Virginia was death. Thomas Jefferson, our very liberal, broad-minded founding father, he lobbied to reduce that punishment to castration. That's pretty harsh, too.
That's pretty brutal.
And by the way, it was shut down. They said, no, that's too lenient. We're not going to do that. When you look in the history of America, there was no established church at the federal level, because there were established churches at the state level.
I guess that's where my argument lies, that the federal government now is trying to take over what was intended for the states to do. And that does make it this contradiction then, because you want some regulation, you don't want anarchy in society, but you don't want the federal bureaucrats to do it. So maybe it's a problem less with our definitions or differences of definition of liberty, and more with who's applying
this
definition. Who
gets to do it, yeah. And by the way, this is a very Catholic idea. It's the Catholic idea of subsidiarity.
Yes.
The idea that you do not want some overweening power to be trampling on the rights and authority of smaller and more local communities. And this goes down all the way to the family, by the way, which is why it's no coincidence that what has the left been gunning for decades? And basically,
our sweet little babies.
Our sweet little babies and our families. Yeah. The fund. This, I'd say, would be one of the really big disagreements between the kind of libertarian-ish view and the conservative view. Is what is the fundamental unit of society? The libertarian, and I use that term loosely, because
everyone goes through a libertarian stage. So I say tongue in cheek, because even I at one point was like, don't tell me what to do unless I'm, trying to kill somebody else. Other than that, stay off my lawn.
Totally. No, we all do. High school was fun. College was fun. But the libertarian view might be that the individual is the basic unit.
Yeah.
But the conservative view is, no, it's the family. Right. Actually. It's not.
And I think that's correct.
Yeah.
That's certainly correct. And not just in my opinion, not just in my religious belief. That's true when you look at the statistics, when you look at both the harm of the destruction of the family and the good when families encourage.
Yeah.
This is actually remember when gay marriage was codified into law? And right before that, when the argument was, should the government be recognizing marriage at all?
Yeah.
Because there was a strain of conservatives that were saying, listen, I'd rather the government not recognize marriages legally at all versus recognizing what, Christians believe is not actually marriage. Right? And the argument from a lot of conservatives is the federal government recognizes man-woman marriage, traditional marriage, because the country needs children. And the best, most stable, obviously, unit for raising those children is a married mother and father.
And if you believe that the family is the fundamental political unit, then to say that the federal government has no role in marriage, it's like saying the federal government has no role in the states or in the counties. It's like saying, if the federal government's not going to recognize the fundamental political union, then why is it recognizing any of the other political units within the country? I mean, it's just
madness. That was the question. Why? What is the interest of the U.S. government in recognizing, male, female, female unions? And I actually still think that question is up in the air. I think it is a political statement and not one that is in the interest of the national security or the general welfare of our country, because any person is perfectly free to, love and commit to any other person. Why on earth do you need, the government to pat your head? And I know that's both a hybrid Catholic opinion and conservative opinion, but it plays into this idea that all of this stuff should be at the state level and not the federal level to begin with.
Though part of it, Scalia brought up this point, which is if you've got one definition, if you've got marriage in normal states, and then you've got this farce of marriage, this kind of caricature of marriage in the liberal states, then how is your nation going to work? You've now got such utter confusion over the most basic political unit. How are you going to function? What is that going to mean for adoption? What is that going to mean when you move? If someone gets married, quote unquote, in New York, and forget about two men or two women, let's take it to its logical conclusion and say it's two men, three women, and a goat. And they just call this union marriage, even though it's has no historical or philosophical grounding in marriage. What happens when you move to Utah? Utah is a good example. I mean, don't forget, Utah used to permit polygamy.
Yeah.
And that was stamped out. And it was a big political fight because the nation could not tolerate one state in the union having polygamy, having one radically different definition of marriage than all of the others. And so it was always going to come to a head. It's just, it's very sad to me that this one romantic poet on the Supreme Court, Anthony Kennedy, decided that the right to, and this is what he said, the right to intimacy is guaranteed to us by the Constitution.
And Where?
Well, it's in the invisible ink beneath
sure.
the emanations
like, is
below
the part that National Treasure discovered on the back?
You know, yeah. Scalia, this great dissent, he goes, if the right to intimacy is granted in the Constitution, I've never seen that anywhere, but if it is, surely marriage constricts rather than expands the right to intimacy. Ask the nearest hippie. I thought, what a beautiful dissent.
And what a beautiful mind.
Yes.
My goodness, I missed that man.
Yeah.
But my goodness.
It exposed the nonsense of that argument, which is still, I mean, we're seeing the cascading effects today. Now there is a move to legalize polygamy, as we all said there would be.
Well, yeah, because they accuse us of engaging in a slippery slope fallacy. But what I always say is, sure, when you're at the top of a slippery slope and you're sitting in a sled, you just might slide down it. That's how it works.
Especially
that's
now, we're
basic
like,
physics.
We're basically three quarters of the way down Kilimanjaro. They say, stop talking about the slippery slope. It's slippery. I'm almost down at the bottom. What are you talking about?
Exactly. So going back to the war on drugs for a second, this is my most controversial political opinion. Are you ready for this?
Yeah.
I'm not actually sure that I've shared this with anybody other than my producers. I think because we have this incredible industry of trafficking, not we, but there exists an incredible industry of trafficking drugs without which our nation would not suffer the opioid deaths that we do. We don't even necessarily need to illegalize many of these drugs. We just need to cut off the supply. Mm. I think we should send in special forces into Mexico and wipe these cartels out and stop the supply.
Yeah, sure. I think that's a great idea. That's for talking about turning the right wingery up to like 11. But it's of course it's in the national security interest of the United States.
These are narco terrorists.
Yeah, and the other thing to remember about the war on drugs, a lot of the libertarian types don't talk about this because they say, they talk about all the terrible things that the war on drugs led to. It led to mass incarceration, which, last time I checked, putting criminals in prison is good. We have a lot of crime in America. I think we have an under-incarceration problem, but that's a topic
talk about
for another
dialing
day.
The right-wingness up to 15.
But the thing people forget about the war on drugs, it worked. Between 1979 and 1999, you had a more than 20% reduction in illegal drug use in the United States. It totally worked. And so very often the more honest people who are arguing for the legalization of all sorts of drugs, they won't say the war on drugs failed from achieving its goals. It did achieve its goals. They'll just say, well, it's wrong.
Philosophically, it's
drug
wrong.
Drug dealers in prison.
Here's why these topics that we're talking about, which are some of the untouchable topics, even among Republicans and conservatives, this is why they are untouchable. Because we have this idea that's been dubbed big tent Republicanism, where we want to invite more people into the party. I'm all for that. I think that's great. But the problem with that is that the people who invented or created big tent Republicanism want to change the principles in order to usher more people into the party. Instead of saying, listen, we're listening to what you want, listening to the struggles that you are facing, and we are going to articulate why our policies best answer and serve you. That's what actual big tent Republicanism is. The onus is on us as conservatives to invite other people who might not typically be Republicans, not to discard our principles in an effort to create a coalition of then what?
There's this meme that I love, and it's a meme of this, crazy looking woman or kind of androgynous person saying, yeah, I'm an atheist, transgender, drug dealing, whatever, all these kind of things. That's right. I'm a conservative, and it's this idea that being a conservative, it doesn't imply any restrictions whatsoever. Just so long as, I guess you want to lower taxes or something, then you're a conservative. And that just isn't true. Obviously, politics is the art of inclusion. You need 50% plus one to win elections and make the laws and do anything. So you need it to be big enough to win elections, but you need it to be small enough to stand for something. Otherwise you don't have a political movement at all. And so the people who are the most hardcore, who say, you know, we can't budge on anything, that's not going to work. And the people who say we need the big tent, and if you're a post-birth abortionist, that's great, come on in, you know, we want your votes, that's not going to work either. I mean, as I thought conservatives understood, moderation is a virtue, and we need to balance a lot of these things, and then hopefully persuade people to move that middle, move that moderate, quote-unquote, position further in the conservative direction.
And we need politicians who are willing to differentiate between their personal moral viewpoint and the law. Meaning you and I actually, I think, do this very well because we are such devout Catholics and because we are proud of our Catholicism and we speak out and we share how it informs our entire life philosophy, let alone our political views, right? You and maybe you and I do this more than anybody else does.
That's why I like the term practicing Catholic. Yeah. Scalia used this too. He's a practicing Catholic. Because, you know, I'm a practicing Catholic. I'm going to keep on practicing until I get it right. You know, it requires a lot of practice.
No, I'm not trying to pat us on the back. I mean, we are sinners just like the rest, but there are so many politicians who are nervous or hesitant or scared to actually take a moral stance. Like we were talking about marriage. It doesn't mean that, you know, that we are intolerant of people who choose to form unions that do not align with our Catholic view of marriage. Not at all.
Yeah, we just burn them at the stake.
Oh yeah. Really funny. Really funny. Thomas Jefferson in his ear, I guess, right now?
The people he was lobbying against, yeah. No, right, of course, you know, one can, I think, I do agree Catholics in particular have a kind of vantage in this because Catholics in a way are kind of outsiders in America.
Yes.
There's this.
We always have been.
Yes. You know, I mean, it was founded by some of my ancestors were these radical Puritans who are rolling in their graves to think that one of their descendants is a Catholic. But It's a strange position because you'll notice most of the big conservatives in recent years in American history have been Catholics. Buckley, Schlafly, Russell Kirk, Brent Bozell.
Biden. I couldn't resist.
But these guys are, why are they all these Catholics in a Protestant country? Well, you know, the Western civilization was formed by Catholicism. It's the only institution that has endured in the West from antiquity to modernity. And there is a coherence to Catholic thought. I mean, I don't mean to sound just too much like a rah-rah papist, but the idea
but
here-
But you are.
But I am. And the point is that there is a coherence to all of these things, that what is true on Sunday at church is also true on Tuesday at the voting booth and is also true on Thursday at the dining hall or wherever you're going to be. And so we can- I do think we have an ability to see a little more clearly some of the contradictions in American politics and then try to work to move them a little bit more
to
into the right direction.
To embrace both the morality and that free will choice. This has been a great discussion. I for one, appreciate it. I always enjoy talking to you. This is the kind of conversation we have off the air anyway. So it was delightful to be able to share it with everyone. If you want exclusive early access to interviews just like this one with Michael Knowles, please join our locals community, LizWheelerShow.com/locals, and you will get exclusive early access to interviews just like this one. Michael, thank you for joining me. It was
thank
great.
Thank you. Pleasure's all mine.
Oh, and before we go, can we differentiate between your fake book and your real book?
I've been trying to, because I have my magnum opus. That is Reasons to Vote for Democrats, A Comprehensive Guide.
The best book to put on your coffee table.
Thank you. Yep. Thank you. And then there is my sequel. Lesser known, you know, it's a sort of minor work, which happens
a not New York Times bestseller.
Both of them are not New York Times. Both of them were, the blank book was a number one Amazon bestseller for about a week and a half. The book with words was a number one Publishers Weekly bestseller. So it sold more than, that sold 40% more copies than the number one New York Times bestseller. No bulk sales, no BS, but the gray lady wouldn't give it to us. Snubbed us from their
it's
list.
It's like a badge of honor,
it's a badge
Michael.
Of honor. It is.
Every time we talk about this, I'm going to bring that up because I'd be frustrated if I were you, but since I'm not you, I'm delighted that it happened because it's such a good way to expose what frauds they are.
Yes, no, I take it as an affirmation, even if it means I won't sell as many books.
Right, it's called Speechless. You can get it wherever books are sold. Michael, thanks for being here.
Thank you.
Thank you. If you haven't already, give this video a thumbs up, hit the subscribe button below, and ring the bell to make sure you never miss a video.